The 1984 Ghostbusters movie is a comedy classic and one of my all-time favorite movies. My family quotes lines from Ghostbusters and the Godfather movies nearly every time we get together, and that's why I was so sad that the all-female Ghostbusters reboot in 2016 sucked in every way possible. I'm determined now to show examples why the humor failed so badly. The cast and director, Paul Feig, along with many others, have tried to blame this film's box office and critical bombing on angry male trolls in their basement throwing fits that, "Zomg, girls are allowed in our beloved franchise." And while I will say that casting based on diversity in lieu of a well-written script with interesting characters and a director that actually wants to be there should turn people off, you know, there's plenty of popular movies with comedic actresses that are beloved by all the same subset of people complaining about Girlbusters. And apparently Hollywood hasn't learned its lesson, because I just saw the pointless trailer for the all-female Ocean's 8 movie that's coming out in 2018. Girlbusters falls on its face because the humor is based on 1, bad improv, 2, a lackluster and scatterbrained script, and 3, being derivative, meta, or doing callback references to the original movie. I went in wanting to like this movie. I bought a ticket in theaters and just prayed. The only joke that I didn't hate, note, not a joke I even laughed at or cracked a smile for, just was mildly bemused by, was in the first 30 seconds of the movie. Now, this whole movie is a dumpster fire of bad joke after bad joke, so I'm not going to systematically go through the entire film and point out why every 20 seconds isn't funny. I really could, but the review would be something like 3 times longer than the actual movie itself. So, here are a few key examples of scenes that absolutely just bewildered me. Salty parabolas. I'm going to compare the tension between the first time the Girlbusters meet a ghost and the library scene from the 84 film.
Okay. How can you be eating right now?
You try saying no to these salty parabolas.
Are you seeing what I'm seeing? Good God. Class 4 apparition. Distinct human form.
This can't be happening. Oh, it's happening, Aura.
That's the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. I'm gonna try to talk to it. Just be careful. She could be malevolent.
Yeah, just make sure you're recording it.
Yeah, I'm getting it all. Okay. Just be cautious. I think she wants to communicate with us.
She seems peaceful.
Hello. I think you're gorgeous.
Hello, hi. My name is Erin Gilbert, doctor of particle physics at Columbia.
It's here.
A full torso apparition, and it's real.
So what do we do? Could you come over here and talk to me for a second, please? Could you just come over here for a second, please? Right over here.
Come here, Francine. Come here. What do we do? I don't know. What do you think? Make contact. One of us should actually try to speak to it.
Good idea. Hello. I'm Peter. Where are you from? Originally. All right. Okay. The usual stuff isn't working.
Okay. I have a plan. I know exactly what to do. Now stay close. Stay close. I know. Do exactly as I say. Get ready. Ready?
Get her!
Ah!
Okay, now you see how in the 84 version you have people acting like actual human beings interacting with the supernatural for the first time? They're afraid, they're unsure, they act like scientists. They don't undercut the tension immediately by having one of the characters treat the situation like it has zero stakes by crunching potato chips. And you can track the characters' emotional shifts through the dialogue and their performances, as well as get hints about what kind of characters these are. Like, for instance, there is so much in that look that Ray and Egon give Venkman, as if to say, which one of us should try talking to the ghost? Well, we're pussies, you're the smooth talker, we're nerds, and we're actual scientists, you gotta be the one to go talk to the ghost. And Melissa McCarthy repeatedly saying the ghost is beautiful, but warns that it might also be malevolent, just doesn't go anywhere. After her friend gets puked on, she could have said something like, yep, definitely malevolent, or, okay, I'm dropping that down to the second most beautiful thing I've ever seen. And I want to bring it back to this Kate McKinnon Pringles crunching, you know, I just can't stop eating, but I have no good reason, and I'm just undercutting any tension that the scene might have thing. So, I mean, I'm just workshopping it here, but she could have said something like, I'm a nervous eater, although that would have made a lot more sense for the Melissa McCarthy character. And then that could have given her something to do for the rest of the movie whenever they're in a dangerous situation. That would have been kind of funny, is to hear just something crunching from off screen and see her, you know, be nervous. And in case you just think I just don't like projectile vomiting jokes, I'm going to show you a clip of the movie Mafia, where it's a gag of projectile vomiting done so well I laugh until I cry every time I watch it.
I had been embraced by the very man whose lifelong vendetta had been to kill my father. And now with my own nephew, he had succeeded. In the quicksand of organized crime, the only option is retribution.
My cup is full!
I wondered how Pop would have handled all of this.
That stuff went everywhere, by the way, in every crack. Very hard to wash off.
Batman, what happened? Are you okay?
He slimed me.
That's great! Actual physical contact! Can you move?
Okay, so you notice how in those two scenes where they're recovering from being slimed, in the 84 one, it's a normal Venkman response to, like, anyone would have to being slimed. It's uncomfortable, I was freaked out, you know, it's embarrassing, whatever. And Ray comedically reacting by being enthusiastic and not responding the way you would anticipate someone. Like, it would generally be concerned for them or whatever. And then in the Girlbusters version, she just describes the discomfort. And there's no joke there. It's just a description of how she felt.
We might be the only ones who can stop it.
Holtzman, come on!
The hat is too much, right? Is it the wig or the hat?
Ain't got no body, and nobody cares for me. Igor, Frederick.
The next clip is comparing the Mike Hat scene in Girlbusters to a scene from Airplane. Both deal with characters being obtuse to the fact that certain words in strange contexts sound similar, and they can be confused for each other. And it also just screams bad improv.
Would it be okay if I bring my cat to work sometimes? He has major anxiety problems.
You know what? I would love to let your cat live here with you, but I have a pretty severe cat allergy.
Oh, I don't have a cat. It's a dog. His name's my cat.
Your dog's name is my cat?
And Mike Hat.
Your dog's name is Mike, last name Hat.
Well, his full name is Michael Hat.
I can't say that I'm allergic to dogs, so...
Yeah, that's all right. He lives with my mom.
Well, then we have that figured out.
Flight 209er, you are cleared for takeoff.
Roger.
Huh? LA departure frequency 123.9er.
Roger. Huh? Request vector. Over.
What? Flight 209er, clear for vector 324.
We have clearance, Clarence.
Roger, roger. What's our vector, Victor?
Tower radio clearance, over.
That's Clarence, over.
Over. Roger.
Huh?
Roger, over.
What?
Hey! Who?
So, in Girlbusters, Thor asks if he can bring in his dog, by name, assuming that everyone will know who he's talking about. Okay, fine. He's dumb. That's arguably something his character might do. But for the joke to work, you need to have a plausible reason for him to have named his dog Michael Hatt. The scene in Airplane works because pilots and air traffic controllers regularly use words like vector, clearance, and Roger. The Michael Hatt joke, quote-unquote, is just contrived. And again, it goes nowhere. There are no stakes for anyone. A character that is mentioned, the dog, is not brought in later. That's like the anti-Chekhov's gun. And as far as improv goes, Thor presents an idea and Melissa McCarthy shoots it down. And then Thor says, I didn't mean what you thought I meant anyway. And then at the end of the scene, he says, oh, it doesn't matter if the dog lives with my mom, so there are no stakes. Again, you're just having characters denying each other time after time after time. The rule of improv is yes and, so you've just failed entirely. And I don't blame Thor, he's not an improv-trained actor, but the rest of the women are. The director should know some of these rules. In conclusion, was this movie a spiteful, man-hating, soulless cash grab that was ready to strangle your childhood in a dark alley? Undoubtedly. Should you be happy that Sony lost $50 million making this piece of shit? Of course. Is criticism of this garbage synonymous with misogyny? Nice try, but no, and you're a bad person if you illegitimately, casually label people misogynists, racist, homophobes, etc.